set out now in a box upon the sea.
While most of us have only experienced the beat rebellion of the 50s and the revolution of consciousness and politics of the 60s peripherally, or at a remove in time, Ed Sanders lived each day at the vital center of both movements. He arrived in New York from Columbia, Missouri, 1 year after On the Road was published, and soon became fast friends with Allen Ginsberg, whose Howl, along with Charles Olson's The Maximus Poems, had begun to change the face of contemporary poetry. Soon, both Ginsberg and Olson were publishing in Ed's groundbreaking mimeographed Fug You, a magazine of the arts. As Ed writes in Fug You, his informal history of the Peace Eye bookstore, the Fug You press, the Fugs, and the counterculture of the Lower East Side, the Beats, through their public presence and publications, pushed at the barricades of what could be said and done. The Ban the Bomb marches, the anti-censorship and early civil rights campaigns of the 50s paved the way for the political activism and sexual liberation movements of the 60s. Fug You, Ed's extraordinary book, documents his journey from NYU, where he majored in Latin and Greek, through underground filmmaking, the battle to decriminalize marijuana, the publication of his own important poetry, the creation of the revolutionary rock band The Fugs, and the establishment of a bookstore, the Peace Eye, that became the meeting ground for all these activities. In Fug You, Ed writes, Olson had had almost as huge an impact on me, particularly the Maximus poems and his manifesto, Projective Verse, as Ginsberg, Dylan Thomas, Poe, Blake, and Eliot. Olson dedicated the Maximus poems to Robert Creeley, the figure of outward. I strived in my own modes to be the figure of outward to my own generation. In a lifetime of extraordinary writing, filmmaking, music, social, political, and environmental activism, and investigative poetry and journalism, Ed has clearly achieved that goal. It is with great pleasure and pride that the Gloucester Writers' Center presents our friend and supporter, our own figure of outward, Ed Sanders. Thank you.
Driving in today, I stopped off at Say Hello to Charles and his wife, Betty. And it's always a pleasure to come back to Gloucester. When I read today from my book, I'll try to read some sections of hanging out with Olson here. But I'll start out with what I call the Fug You bust. Is when I was arrested in January 2nd, 1966 with a big police raid on my bookstore. But I have to first describe how that happened. When I was a wild young man in 1961 and two, I used to hang out at the Catholic Worker on Christie Street in New York City. Many of my friends were activists with the Catholic Worker. You know, they'd go out and sell the Catholic Worker on the streets and cost a penny, but you'd get a quarter. And if the Catholic Worker had lax rules, and then they allowed their staff to use some of that money to buy what was the beatnik beer of choice, Rheingold. Rheingold, 25 cents a quart. And so one February of 1962, I and my friends, mainly from the Catholic Worker, were fascinated with a movie being shown on Avenue B in New York City at an old vaudeville theater called the Charles Theater, where Jonas Mekas was putting on a series of films. And the film being shown was Guns of the Trees by the Mekas brothers. And I went because it was narrated by my hero, Allen Ginsberg. And we went there, and it was we used to read Jonas Mekas's columns in the Village Voice. He wrote on underground film, way before underground was anything. He would write about Stan Brakhage. He helped Jack Smith make his movies. When I went into filmmaking, underground filmmaking, he found a laboratory that would develop my somewhat erotic footage. And so Jonas was a hero of all of us. So we went to see his movie. And it had a line in the movie, something like, I saw all those groped by J. Edgar Hoover in the silent halls of Congress. So that was a lightning bolt. So we went out to a drink at a bar that was where all the mainly painters, you know, Larry Rivers would drink there, and Harry Smith, the filmmaker and artist, occultist, that's where I met him. Anyway, we went out there after this movie, which was right across the street, and I was all turned on. I said, I'm putting out a magazine called Fug You, a Magazine of the Arts. And they said, sure, Ed, yeah, okay. So, but a couple of days later, I went out on 2nd Avenue and bought a $35 hand-cranked mimeograph machine where you poured ink in the top of the drum. And I said, I lived in a pad that had the bathtub in the kitchen with a porcelainized cover. So I put the mimeograph down on the porcelainized cover, and I went down to the Catholic Worker, where I, you know, you could get a good free lunch. It made wonderful soup, and I got bowling shoes from their clothing dispensary on the second floor, and I typed. I got a bunch of poems, many of them from staff members of Catholic Worker, and I borrowed some Catholic Worker stencils, and I used a Catholic Worker typewriter, and then I borrowed Catholic Worker paper and took it back to my pad and printed this up and gave it out free. And I started mailing, and I put out a bunch of issues. And Dorothy Day, who's now going to be a saint, got wind that the Catholic Worker typewriter and stencils had been used for something called Fug You, a Magazine of the Arts, and she put a kibosh on, so I couldn't get my free lunch there anymore, and the staff were banned from publishing in my magazine, although a couple of them resigned. And anyway, I began giving it out, and it had a grabby title. Later, when I ran for the county legislature in Woodstock, this is a few years ago, the word had gotten out to the Republicans that I had put out something called Fug You, a Magazine of the Arts. So all of a sudden, I was having to have a press conference. And I said, yeah, well, I wanted a grabby title. grabby title, you know. So anyway, so I began mailing this out to my heroes. I mailed one to Fidel Castro. I mailed one to Samuel Beckett and Ussi Sirmar, and I got his address. I mailed one to Allen Ginsberg, whom I heard was very depressed and hanging out in India with Peter Orlovsky. And I mailed one to Fidel Castro, Nikita Khrushchev, and a bunch of poets. You know, among them was, I got the address of Charles Olson here in Gloucester, and I started mailing him copies. And to my lasting gratitude, I started getting a bunch of of submissions of manuscripts from Robert Duncan and from Diane De Prima, Amiri Baraka, then known as Leroy Jones, Frank O'Hara, Ted Berrigan, and Michael McClure, but also Charles Olson sent me a nice letter back and some Maximus poems to print. And I was extremely impressed with first it was Edgar Allan Poe, and then it was Dylan Thomas and Ezra Pound. And then I discovered at the 8th Street Bookshop, I discovered the Maximus poems, and Maximus from Dogtown one, which completely changed my life. And then I read, of course, Projective Verse, and I never thought I would ever be a friend of Allen Ginsberg or Charles Olson, but Olson was the kind of guy that, you know, I was 22 years old. I think I knew more Greek than he did, because I was a Greek major, so I could sight read Plato, and, you know, so I had one language that I had him bumped. And, but, you know, and so I would come up in subsequent years to hang out with him here in Gloucester, and he accepted me, even though I was 23, 24 years old, as almost a compatriot, you know. He liked some of the poems I was writing, and he kept talking about guys like Tom and Bill, and I didn't know who in the hell they were, and then I realized he was talking about T.S. Eliot and William Carlos Williams. So he accepted all poets by a first name basis. So anyway, it became very popular to be in my magazine, and I hand drew the stencils, and I adorned them with Egyptian hieroglyphs, because I studied Egyptian at the New School, and I could sight read coffin texts, and so I was always putting these images in my magazine, so it became kind of an Egyptian flavored vehicle. It grew, and then I graduated from New York University in 1964, and I was going to go to graduate school to study Indo-European linguistics, but I sent in my application for NYU too late. So in 1964, I needed to earn a living, so I opened up the Peace Bookstore on East 10th Street in an old kosher meat market, where I left the Hebrew for strictly kosher on the glass and just put Peace Eye Bookstore, strictly kosher. And had moved my mimeograph machine there, and we started putting out the committee to legalize marijuana, the marijuana newsletter, and I published my magazine. Allen Ginsberg lived just down the street, and I began to get the attention of the police. You know, I was making underground films in what I called the secret location, which was on Avenue A in a back building. And the police raided that back building and took every single roll of developed and undeveloped film I'd had there. Meanwhile, I started, Tuli Kupferberg lived next door to the Peace Eye, and he and I started the band called the Fugs, because we noticed that poets, after poetry readings, would go to this dance club and would be dancing to Beatles. It'd be Amiri Baraka and Robert Creeley and Ed Dorn. I mean, they'd be dancing to this rock and roll. So we thought, well, we'll. It was the time, you know, it was the time of the happening movement. You know, you could rent a storefront and get a smoke gun and get a couple of people to take off their clothes and dance up and down in bathtubs full of grapes and charge admission. So we decided to get in on that. And so we quickly wrote a bunch of songs and then started performing. A couple of our early Fugs members were junkies, so they kept nodding out in the middle of gigs, so we kept refining our act, is what I'm saying. And Harry Smith, whom I thought he was just a filmmaker and an artist. I didn't realize he was a famous folklore, you know, American anthology of folk music. Anyway, he had a connection to Folk Ways Records, and he said, hey, you know, this was after we started playing at a bunch of theaters. We had developed our act in off-Broadway theaters, basically, for 2 or 3 years. And so we got to a point where we thought we could record. So he arranged with Mo Ash for us to record an album. And they brought a contract in, and he had sold it to Mo Ash on the grounds that we were the Fugs jug band. And so we just scratched jug band off of the contract. Anyway, we began to take off. We grew popular. It was amazing. We do midnight shows at the Bridge Theater where Jack Smith's Flaming Creatures was shown and created a, you know, when Norman Mailer freaked out and wanted to punch people after seeing it. And so we played there, and then we would have, there'd be people in limousines, you know, like Richard Burton and Tennessee Williams, you know. We had this song called Toe Queen Love, and he says, personally, I prepare Peach Pit. Anyway, so anyway, we were more and more popular. So, and my I was very active in the marijuana newsletter, and it just was, the heat was starting to rise. So we did a concert on January 2nd, 1966, at the Bridge Theater. And this is the story of the raid on Peace. The Fugs gave a midnight concert at the Bridge Theater, January 1 to 2, after which I went home to our apartment on East 27th Street and hit the hay. Then zonk, 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 there was an insistent buzzing of the downstairs door around 4:30. It was Thule Kupferberg. He said there were policemen inside Peace. We took a cab back down to 383 East 10th. The lights were on inside the store and a window was broken. There were police cars outside, and there were a couple of police officers in the store. A few were also in the middle room where I kept the Fug You Press mimeograph machine and piles of uncollated publications, such as the Toe Queen poems, the marijuana newsletter, the Fug songbook, Bugger, Auden's Platonic Blow, and various issues of Fug You, a magazine of the arts. The officers were examining some pages. I was wondering what it all meant as I grabbed a hammer and some wood and started boarding up the broken window and fixing the front door. A cop was stationed on the outside, outside on the street. And as I was hammering, he said, you know, I don't care personally, but the sergeant is upset. In recent months, I'd begun to get the attention of law enforcement. For one thing, an undercover police informant had auditioned for the band. So I couldn't help but wonder, had the police deliberately smashed their way in? It was not long before I became aware of Sergeant Charles Fetta, who was then assigned to the 9th Precinct. Fetta did seem upset and appeared to have a case of phallophobia, commingled, I thought, with a splash of phallophilia, because he seemed miffed about instances of exposed male genitalia in some of my publications. Maybe a bit too miffed. He asks, are all these publications yours? I thought I should show some confusion and not really answer. My generation knew Lenny Bruce's dictum, deny, 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 to the walls of our being. So I thought maybe if I appeared vague, I could avoid legal trouble. Next, the sergeant's hand seemed to tremble as he thrust an issue of Fug You, a magazine of the arts, close to my face. What about that? He asked as he pointed to the cover. He was clutching the cover to volume 5, number 4, which showed a boy I had copied from a Danish tobacco package at the cigar store where I worked on Times Square. Next to the lad was an Egyptian deity with a peace sign on his head and a spurting phallus. He wanted to know what the cover meant. Was that bird threatening that boy? What's that bird gonna do with that boy? The sergeant was so upset over the cover that I was later surprised when it did not show up as one of the exhibits in my trial the following year. I was placed under arrest, and the police carted away some valuable boxes of my publications, tens of thousands of dollars worth, as measured in eBay wealth. I asked for a receipt, which they promised to supply but never did. The 9th Precinct headquarters was at 321 East 5th. The 9th covers the whole alphabet part of the Lower East Side. We arrived at the polished wood-paneled front doors, which to me had a kind of medieval feel to them. We pushed through and inside, and the officers within the precinct house seemed eager for my arrival. Indeed, there was a marked contrast of facial expressions between the grumpy arresting officer and the policeman at the station house. For being such a serious matter, there certainly was a lot of mirth in the 9th precinct. "Hey, you're Peace Eye," one officer boomed. I nodded. "Hello, Peace Eye," another exclaimed. I nodded. "Let's take a look," another commented and smiled, and laughing officers passed magazines hand to hand. But during the time they were showing the magazines, several police officers were carefully examining the New York State Penal Code to find a felony to place upon me. I subtly informed them that it was a misdemeanor. It was. So all they could come up with to validate the sergeant's trembles and shakes was a misdemeanor charge of possession of obscene literature with intent to sell. So I was asked to sit at a desk where an officer asked me questions and typed on a non-electric typewriter. Peck, peck, peck. Name, address, phone, age, weight, height. Then he asked if I had any tattoos, to which I replied, no. Meanwhile, various officers kept on chuckling and chortling, reading through issues of Fug You. About a half hour later, my arresting officer, Sergeant Feta, along with another officer, came into the room where I was being questioned. Feta said, "Okay, Sanders, get into that room and take off your clothes." "What's up?" I replied. Then I noticed he was holding the very issue whose cover had so upset him back at B-side. "I thought you said you didn't have any tattoos." He was pointing to the notes on contributors page, where I often placed humorous and speculative comments about the poets in the issue. In this particular issue, I stated that Ed Sanders had, quote, the Ankh symbol tattooed on his penis, and the first 53 hieroglyphs of Akhenaten's Hymn to the Sun disc on his nuts. I was escorted to the bathroom, where I was asked to lower my trousers. Then the two of them bent down fairly closely. I thought a bit too closely to scope my pants down groin area in a vain search for Akhenaten's Hymn to the Sun. I was grateful that they did not lean down so closely that I could feel the huffs of their agitated nostrils upon my privies. So we passed through the bowels of the, we went from the police station to the tombs, which is the court building, and we were going through, and I leaned to Sergeant Fettis, you know, I know when I win this case, I'm gonna have a big party, I'm gonna invite you to it. So I began a nightmare. It was like 15 or 17 court hearings I had to go to during the next year and a half. I went over and over again. I went to the New York Civil Liberties Union, and to my lasting and eternal gratitude, the ACLU took my case. And so I had a really sharp lawyer who later became a state Supreme Court judge, Ernst Rosenberger. Anyway, we kept going to court. Meanwhile, in the early court hearings, I tried to pack the place, but the Fugs were growing. We had a record out, it got on the charts, we were selling out. We moved to a theater on McDougal Street in the summer of 66, which we sold out three shows a night. We started to tour, and we signed with Atlantic Records, and we were making our first album for Atlantic Records. So I decided not to emphasize the fact that I might go to jail for, you know, my magazine. So I just stopped trying to get publicity for it. So the Fugs were, you know, we were recording our album for Atlantic Records. And meanwhile, we were looking for a trio. I was going to be tried before a trio of judges. And we wanted to get the judges that hadn't convicted Lenny Bruce a year or so ago. So we were looking for the miraculously woven together trio of judges that had not fried Lenny. And so meanwhile, I was fooling around with the minds of the judge. Early in 67, one of the court hearings, I went dressed in white. I had a white suit, white tie, white shoes, white pants, everything white. That was okay. And I had an Eye of Horus that was on my lapel. The next hearing, though, I went all in red. Red shoes, red boots, red corduroy pants, red sports coat, red tie, red shirt. And the judge said, "Young man, this is not a ski lodge." He says, "When you come into my court, I want you to be properly dressed." So I said, "Yes, sir. Yes, sir." So then I became a regular defendant attire. So we finally, in May, I had two expert witnesses ready to testify, John Ashbery and Kenneth Cope. So we had the miraculous trio, none of whom had fried Lenny. So the ACLU lawyer said, "Let's go. Let's go to court." So we decided to go to trial. So I call up Kenneth Koch, who's playing tennis at the Columbia University tennis. So he's the only expert witness in the history of world civilization that appeared to testify holding a tennis racket. So he's sitting there in the front row along, and I called John Ashbery, and they were there ready to testify. So I'll read some of the trial. It was kind of interesting. Okay, so the process, so we had three judges, and they were there. And the prosecutor was Assistant District Attorney John Moyna. One indication that we might sail through this nightmare occurred when I heard Moyna, while reading the indictment, pronounce lascivious as lascivous. So the fact we had a low-burning wick on the plus the prosecutor's strategy was to that they entered into exhibits certain of my ads that I had, these satiric ads that I had run for my underground films, and that I was promoting pornography. Like I had one ad, so-called. I had a picture of an Egyptian goddess with a snake head, and she's holding two, she's standing there with her snake head, and she's holding two knives. And I have the caption, "Fug You, a magazine of the arts, promoting pornography through its subsidiary, the Lady Dickhead Advertising Company." So this was one of the exhibits to show that I was pandering and selling pornography. So, and they also had a book of stills from Flaming Creatures, and they claimed that every single photograph in that book was obscene. Anyway, we went to trial, and the cop testified, and they brought up the Lady Dickhead Advertising Company thing, and they brought up various ads that I had made for my underground films. And at the conclusion, then I was going to bring up Kenneth Koch and John Ashbery, but my ACLU guy said, he said, "Why don't we just rest and say they haven't shown their case?" And we did, and we rest. And it made me feel good about the United States justice system. These three judges, cranky guys, voted unanimously that they hadn't proved their case, and I was set free. So I turned around to invite Feta to the big party, and he was gone. So that's the story of the Fug You bust. After I was arrested, a few weeks later, I went up with a woman named Panna Grady to, she'd throw these fancy parties. She had a nice apartment in the Dakota, and she was always throwing these parties for Gunter Grass, and she was giving money to William Burroughs and novelists. And I said to her, one of these parties, I said, "I know a great poet. I mean, why don't you start supporting poets? There's this guy in Gloucester, Massachusetts, who's a great genius, and he's not wealthy. And why don't you?" So anyway, a few months later, we drove up to Gloucester and we went out to dinner at the tavern. In October, Panna sent me a letter inviting me up to see her and Charles, she had rented a place. It is the story of a psilocybin voyage. I decided to take up Panna and Charles' kind invitation to visit. Ken Weaver and I flew to New York to Boston on the Eastern Shuttle, then took a cab to Gloucester to see the O in mid-afternoon, his morning. Olson had to clear away books from the stove to make us tea. We had dinner, and then we were sitting in the kitchen at Fort Square. We were to stay the night in the house rented by Panna Grady. She was not there. Olson had a bottle of orange-red psilocybin pills, plus a bottle, literally a bottle of acid, he'd gotten from Tim Leary. He went into the back room and returned with the bottles of LSD and psilocybin. "Want a swig?" he said, thrusting the liquid acid in my direction as if it were a shot of rum in a bar by Half Moon Bay. "A swig?" I exclaimed. I knew full well that 500 micrograms was more than enough, so why should we risk 500,000 gulps? So we settled on the psilocybin. Olson had apparently tried some in December of 60 and February of 61, and there was the remainder in a bottle almost 6 years later. He shook out a handful of orange-red pills. I took about 8. Weaver had 12, and Olson, at 6'7", had an initial 12 or so, then a few more. We sat talking in the kitchen as the magic mushrooms began to bring us the galactic mush. Olson drove us over near the part of Gloucester called Dogtown where we were to sleep. He drove slowly, so slowly that when I looked back, a line of cars was close pressed behind us. He pulled over, as I recall, to let some of them roll by. Then we proceeded. I felt a great surge of confidence that my mentor, the O, was driving and would get us there safely. Then I glanced to the front seat, and Olson had turned into the Greek god Poseidon. Literally, the horse from the sea with kelp in his mane, matted and wet. So onward drove Poseidon, the seat cushions washed in the froth of his greeny mane. Well, I thought, even if I am bonkers, the driver, my hero, my guru, my bard, was safety assured. Until we passed a clump of what appeared to be boulders in the gloom to the left. Woo! Look at the elephants, Poseidon shouted. At last we arrived in the stone house rented by Panna with stone arched doorway and sat in the living room to talk. Meanwhile, the psilocybin was having a profound effect on me. It seemed as if the house had become the Chapel Perilous, and I began to walk outdoors, spend a few minutes in the dark, and then return to the chapel. I did this a few times and seemed to live through life cycles as I left the house, walked through the woods, then returned. In one life cycle, I spoke Akkadian, building a mud brick hut by the river Euphrates. In another cycle, I was a Hasidic store owner on Hester Street in the Lower East Side. Weaver kidded me later about calling out to the trees when I wandered out of the stone house and onto the lawn. Olson, meanwhile, talked onward. Weaver pointed toward Olson. Look at those sparks coming out of his forehead. I looked. The top of his head seemed enormous and was showering with blue arcs. Then I went out. When I went outdoors, Olson warned me about the quarry. I recalled he was speaking about sachems and Algonquin law lodges. Finally, in one of the life cycles, I got lost in the woods, crashing among trees, leaves, and long hair. I must point out that I was in my full rock and roll attire, all in red, red boots, red sweater, red pants, and a red scarf. Finally, I thrashed down to a street. I thought maybe there had been an accident and I was dead, and maybe might have been in Sheol or Purgatory or some kind of William Burroughs gray zone. I walked through deserted Gloucester streets and was just getting ready to go into a house for shelter. Good thing I didn't. A police car came along and I hailed it. He was at first suspicious of a young man dressed all in red with leaves affixed up and down the redness. I recalled poet Garrett Lansing's address on Main Street in Gloucester, and I called him from the police station. Garrett's friend Derek picked me up and drove me back to Dogtown, where Olson and Weaver were still talking. It seemed they had not moved an inch during my adventure. I called Miriam at our pad on Avenue A, and once again she helped me to land from another trip into this universal mosaic. She always talked me down from on the road orbit during those years. During the psilocybin trip, I was thinking I should give up the Fugs and return totally to poetry. I told Miriam that over the phone from Gloucester, but I was trapped in Fug land. Okay, 306. Olson got a gig to do what are known the Beloit poetry lectures in the March of 1968. And just before he went on the out to deliver those lectures. I called him in Gloucester, and I told him about a plan. I was involved with planning demonstrations in Chicago for the Youth International Party, otherwise known as the Yippies. And I had asked a bunch of poets, D.A. Levy, Ed Dorn, and now Charles Olson, to write a mantra that demonstrators could chant in the streets of Chicago to keep it peaceful. So on March 14th, I wasn't home, but my wife Miriam wrote down what he dictated in the way of a mantra to chant. And he was on his way, he called from the Chicago airport on the way to deliver his lectures titled Poetry and Truth at Beloit College. Here's Olson's, it didn't work, there was a lot of riots in Chicago. Planned in creation, aroused the nation. Blood is the food of those gone mad. Blood is the food of those gone mad. Blood is all over already the nation. Planned in creation, arouse the nation. Blood is the food of those gone mad. That was the year of Martin Luther King's assassination, Robert Kennedy's assassination, the election of Richard Nixon, the bombing of Hanoi in December. Then, a few weeks later, the Fugs were on the road, and Olson was staying with the editor, Donald Allen, in San Francisco. So the Fugs were hanging out a lot with other rock and rollers. So one of our good friends with Janis Joplin, and we stayed at the Tropicana Motel, which was the rock and roll motel on Santa Monica Boulevard. And Janis was partying a lot with our drummer, Ken Weaver, and she had a knack for swimming topless. And so one morning, nobody was out there. It was all alone. And suddenly Janis is swimming, and all of a sudden there's guys walking their dogs. You know, the place is filling up like a concert, you know. And so I got a call from the desk clerk, Mr. Sanders, you're going to have to check out if Ms. Joplin continues to swim nude. So we had to, you know, had to go out and reel her in. Anyway, she was working on her album, which became Cheap Thrills, and she was looking for songs. So Olson was staying with Don Allen. So I thought it would be good to introduce the two. And maybe he could write a song, but you know, both were single, so I thought maybe I would fix them up. And so I got Don Allen was an editor for Grove Press, so we put it on Grove Press expense account, a nice all expense paid meal at a fancy Chinese restaurant with Olson, and I got him to sit next to Janis Joplin, and we were all eating. But Olson kept talking about the Donner Party. And Sutter Mill and stuff like that. And so hope of uniting the text of Great Bard with Great Singer, and maybe even Love Flash from Great Bard with Great Singer, fell apart because she went off and played pool. Well, I've probably gone on enough. I'll close with my hymn to O. I don't know. There's always some people in your life that impact you enormously. And Olson was one of them. He wrote the introduction to a book of poems that, you know, I did not expect it. You know, I was just so amazed when he mailed this to me. And it's late 1964. Anyway, so when he passed away, I wrote this hymn to O. And the last part is sung, and it has a bunch of fragments from several books of the Maximus poems. I set out now in a box upon the sea, and then various quotes. The great ocean is angry at once the perfect child. And then that final beautiful one-liner poem, my wife, my car, my color, and myself. That's at the end of the poem. Hymn to O. There was a term of Anaximanders that inflamed my youth. Ta Aperon, it's Greek. The uncrossable, the boundless, the cause of all. And really, for years, went batty for Ta Aperon. Used to think all the time about the Aperon. Pisai, my book of verse, was part of it. I, heart, minds, shooting the rapids to vanish in the lake, outbound to Pisai. That was part. To make poems history again, that was the sum. Anaximander graphed the thrill of the first map, the, quote, perimetros, unquote, as they called it. I had a vision after Olson's death of two different things. One, that he walked up to a twisted circle of rope with the ends lashed together where they met, the shin sign of Egypt, sigil aeternitatis, and leaped through it as if it were a tire swing. The second, that somewhere, somehow, when that famous fairy's pole struck the brass shores, he ran into a posse of pre-Socratics who drew him forthwith into a delicate discourse. There can never be enough of dignity when bards fly flash to the shore. I can feel you, Charles, when I stare at the froth of Gloucester's tanny rocks. You're there next to the O boat, talking with Alfred Whitehead. Anaximander is there holding a 10-dimensional sphere. A lone Ionian column stands on a hill. I see you, O, bending at the base, writing a line upon the whiteness. You dive again, like a dolphin on antique silver. Through the shin sign's ring, Anaximander with a perimetros of, quote, earth and the sea and the sphere of the sky, unquote, and the endless oatmeal of the Aperon. Hey, Charles, oh, Charlie Olson has entered the cartouche. And this is a prayer that he and Anaximander walk down through the fields together. Oh, what a map they will make. I set out now in a box upon the sea, so few have the polis in their eye. I set out now in a box upon the sea. I'm going to hate to leave this earthly paradise. I set out now in a box upon the sea. Oh, the great ocean is angry. It wants a perfect child. I set out now in a box upon the sea. I am making a mappe Monday. It is to include my being. I set out now in a box upon the sea. My wife, my car, my color, and myself. I set out now in a box upon the sea.